Vagartha vivasam praktau Vagartha pratipaddaye Jagata pitarau vande Parvati parameswarau Mukam karoti vachalam Pangham langayate girim Yatkrupa tamaham vande Paramananda madhavam Sadashiva samarambham Shankaracharya madhyamam Asmadacharya paryantam Vande guru paramparam Parthaya pradibhoditam Bhagavata Narayanena swayam Vyasena gratita purana munina Madhye Mahabharatam Advaita Amrita Varshini Bhagavati Agrasadhyayani Ambatvam Anusandhadami Bhagavad Gita Bhavadveshini Namostu Devyasa Vishala Buddhe Laravindayata Patranetra Yena Tvaya Bharata Taila Purnaha Prajvalito Jnanamaya Pradipaha Prapanna Parijataya Totra Vetraika Panaye Jnana Mudraya Krishnaya Gita Amrita Duhe Namaha Sarvopanishado Gavu Dokta Gopala Nandana Partho Vatsa Sudhir Bokta Dukdam Gita Amrita Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Charura Mardanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum Hari Om.
So we have reached the last day of this Gita Yajna. And it gives me great pleasure to have my Guru by the side of me. Because all that I have learned belongs to several of them, including my Guru, Brahmasri Ramakrishna. I am very happy that you are able to come today. So we have almost come to the end of the chapter. Yesterday, we saw those shlokas which are Jnana Prashamsa. Krishna, after in the chapter 4, Sri Krishna, after this elaborate discussion on Yajna, the last 12 shlokas are Jnana Prashamsa, because that is required. Now think about this situation. There is one person sleeping. During sleep, he is going through a dream. It's a very interesting dream. In reality, he is a pauper. But in the dream, he is a king, having so much of wealth. So the dream is a very interesting dream. He is going through it. In the middle of the dream, as the dream is going on, in the middle of the dream, one thief is actually taking away a lot of those jewels and running. This is a part of the dream. He is going through that process. His friend is sleeping by his side. So this man, in the middle of the sleep, he started shouting, "Catch the thief." In the big way you are shouting, "Catch the thief," he is taking the jewels and running away. Now the question is, what should his friend do? Friend is awake. The question is, what should he do? This is the question now. This man is going through a dream. In the dream, he has a lot of money, and that money and the jewels are being taken away by a thief. The thief is running. And as part of the dream, he is shouting, please catch the thief, catch the thief. Now this friend has two options, who is awake. First option is to catch the thief, who doesn't exist. But our friend is saying, please catch the thief. This is one possibility. Second possibility, which is more sensible, is to wake him up. You first wake him up so that the thief will go. See, Nivarana there is only waking up, not going with what is happening in the dream. So this is what Sri Krishna is doing in this chapter. We are all in dream. And we have assumed so many things about life. We say, I want name, I want fame, I want power, I want position, I am the most brilliant person, I know everything, therefore everything that I do must be correct. And all my efforts must be rewarded with results. I mean, we have thousands of such ideas with which we are living. And that is the root cause of all this stress. This stress is like shouting in the dream. The pleasure and the pain that we are going through is exactly like this fellow shouting in the dream. Because Tattva Jnana is not that. The reality is not that. The reality is that, as Shankaracharya says, Shuddha Buddha Mukta. You know, that is the kind of words he uses. Our existence is so beautifully explained like that, but we have completely given it up. And we are going through every day of fighting and pressure and success and failure, and we attribute things and we have a sense of ahankara, we have a sense of entitlement. We think we are doing everything, we can make anything happen, and we also fall by all the troubles and everything. So Sri Krishna is bringing all these, jnana prashamsa is the process of waking us up. He is saying, I will not allow you to go on like this. Or I am not going to go and then satisfy your pleasures and pains by addressing it. Best thing is to wake you up. So we are all sleeping in the waking state. Gada Nidra. So this is a very deep Nidra. So that has to be shaken. So that is what we have seen. And we have almost come to the end of the chapter now. Yesterday I talked about four principles of knowledge. This is the great thing about the last 12 shlokas in chapter 4. There are principles which never go wrong. Four principles. He said, Sarvam Karma Akilam Jnane Parisamapyate. This is a cardinal principle of knowledge. All action must lead and finally end in knowledge. This is the first principle he said. Yataidamsi, another case, he said, right? Basbasat Kurute Arjuna, in the same way, all in the jnana, all the karma will get burnt. This is the second cardinal principle of knowledge which he said. Then he said, Jnana Plavanena Vrijinam Samdarishyati. The only way to cross the ocean of distress and sins is knowledge. That's the third principle he said. Then he brought a fourth principle about knowledge, Jnanam. He said, Nahi Jnanena Sadrisham Pavitra Miha Vidyate. None of these are fundamental, in mathematics they call it as axioms. I was using the word axiom. These are all theorems. If I have to use mathematical word, theorem. Theorem 1, theorem 2, theorem 3, theorem 4, it can never go wrong. So we saw four of them. There is one last one which we have to see. With that, the chapter is over. The Jnana Prashamsa is over. So we will see those two, three shlokas are there. We will just see and then bring it to a formal conclusion. Yesterday, we talked about the lakshanas of jnana, jnana lakshanani. We said there are, when we say jnana, we said there are a few important things. First, most important thing is jnana is not knowledge. That is not what you read in a book. That is not what you memorize and you say, I am very thorough. I have understood. Understanding by intellectual exercise is not jnana. Jnana sampadanam, that may be step one, but that is not jnana. Jnana is in the domain of anubhuti. Finally, it is anubhuti. That is the first lakshana of jnana. Any jnana, whether it is loka jnana or it is paramarthika jnana, whatever it is, jnana is finally matter of only anubhuti, not in terms of theory, not in terms of memorizing shlokas and I can recite. All those are not, they are all level one. So the first lakshana of jnana is, it must come out of, the spuranam must happen inside. That happens only through anubhuti. And this, the whole idea of this jnana is, it will wipe off the entire past. That's why I gave the example of that mirage in the desert. First time when you go and see it and see there is no water on the tar road, there is no water in the mirage in the desert, it ends that, samshaya forever. Next time you may see, but you know it is, there is no water. So jnana, this ultimate jnana will once and for all wipe off all samshaya. But the apparent mithya will exist. Mithya will be there, but it will not come in any our way of how we do vyavahara. That is the second important thing which we talked about. And what is this jnanasya lakshana? Nitya, anitya, viveka will come. What is nitya? What is anitya? What is satya? What is mithya? What is required? What is not required? Because this is the problem we are going through. This clarity, this clarified thinking, until we get it, we have not got jnana. So that is the real meaning of getting jnana. The nitya, anitya, vastu, vichara will give us that viveka. Lots of things will get clarified without an iota of doubt. Then as in Mundaka Upanishad, Shaunaka asked, kasmin vijnate sarvamidam vijnatam bhavati. That's how he asked Angirasa. So jnana, after attaining jnana, there is nothing more to ask. In fact, this very domain of asking, everything will fall. Everything will fall. That is the jnanasya lakshana. So as long as we have not reached it, we have not obtained the jnana. So that is the next one we saw. And the last thing is, jnana gives us the clarity of this jiva jagat ishvara sambandha. We have not understood any of this. We all think these are all different entities. This triangle is properly connected. When samyak jnana is there, all these gets resolved. So these are some of the jnana lakshanas which are generally talked about. And because of these lakshanas of jnana, all those principles are eminently applicable. Otherwise, for chemistry and biology, none of these. After reading biology, our stress level will only increase. It will not come down. Our doubts in life will only increase. It will not come down. They are all called aparavidya. They are of no, they are vyavaharartham. We have to make salary, we have to make a living. For all that, it is fine. They are not jnana. So in this journey, Krishna takes us to the next principle of jnana, which is also a very important one. So we'll see that. Shraddha vallabhate jnanam tatparasam yatendriyaha jnanam labdhva param shantim achirenadhi gacchati. So he brings the next principle of related to jnanam, knowledge. He says, there are three things he is saying there. Shraddha, tatparaha, samyate indriyaha. There are three things he is saying. To obtain knowledge, we need shraddha. All of them are following from shraddha. Shraddhaval labhate jnanam. So he says, in order to obtain jnana, you need shraddha. Now this word shraddha, anyway, we'll see the shloka and then we'll look at it. Tatparaha, you have to be committed to knowing. The deep desire to know is required. That is the second important thing. Samyate indriyaha. Indriya nigraha is required. The distraction should not happen. The chittasi ekagrata, chitta indriyasi ekagrata. Atyavashyakam. So these are the three things that he is saying. And he says, having obtained jnanam, jnanam labdhva, having obtained jnanam, param shantim achirena adhigacchati. That's why once you obtain jnana, takshane eva sarvam parivartanam bhavati. All the past is irrelevant. At that stage, everything is that param shantim, prashanta gambiram, prashanta gambiryam. That kind of a bhava will come. We saw in Bhagavatam, 3 days back, how when Kuchela came and Krishna received him, there is this description of Kuchela by Sudama by Krishna. He said he was a Prashanta Gambhirya Bhava. That will only a jnani has that sense of feeling. So he says, Shantim Achirena Adhikachati. He reaches unto that. It is a transformation that happens. Before that, what happened is unimportant. When Jnana Siddhi Abhavata, the transformation happens. Now the Shraddha, the most important thing is Shraddha here. The others we have actually spoken in the other earlier things, so we can focus on Shraddha. Now this word Shraddha is one of the words which my own understanding dealing with the modern world, number one, the word Shraddha is not understood. But most importantly, the word Shraddha is looked down upon. People think it is a old style thinking. And some of my students, some of my other friends also tell me, Shraddha means blind faith. I keep telling them, faith is always blind. Don't add blind to it. The very meaning of faith is it is blind. You don't have to put one more adjective for that. Faith is always blind. Now we'll try to understand this notion of Shraddha. Actually, there is one Shraddha Suktam. He says, Shraddha, you know, Shraddham Kamasya Mataram. It says, the mother of the desire is Shraddha. That's what it says in that Shraddha Suktam. It says, and there are very nice mantras in that. This suddenly came to my mind. So what is this Shraddha? First we look at, our Vyavaharika pearl. Then we'll go to Paramarthika. Because there it has a much deeper meaning. See, if you ask, first of all, it is my own understanding, without Shraddha, it is impossible to lead a life even a moment. All these so-called modern thinkers will say, what is all this faith? Faith is not required and so on. I first ask them, what is your date of birth? Then they say some date. I said, who said that? Because on the day you were born, you knew nothing. Your faith is on only two, a piece of paper. For all you know, if that piece of paper is written differently, that's all. I must tell you, in IIT Madras, when I graduated, we had two sweepers. The father sweeper's age was 53. Actually, his age was 82. Okay? And the son, his son's age was 60. So we gave a send-off party for the son. The father could not come. With a walking stick, he came. Because as per IIT record, he was 53. Because after January 1, 1973, only after that, registration of birth and death was compulsory. But in our family, earlier what will happen, the child is too naughty, they'll just take them on Vijay Dashami day, tell some date of birth and then put them in the school. Now in our family, we are going through a very complicated problem. The problem is, in my previous generation, two sisters have a date of birth of only 3 months difference. Because simply there are those days, they will simply go and then tell some date and then, what I am trying to say, your date of birth is a Shraddha. Your life starts with only belief. If you don't believe, it is impossible to lead a life. So my date of birth is purely in the domain of faith. I did not know. My father told me, or some piece of paper told that I am born on so and so date. That's the end of the story. And that piece of paper are completely wrong with my previous generation. That's the example I was giving. So, Shraddha is, I'll give you another example. Let's say I have a chest pain. I go and meet a cardiologist. So this cardiologist looks at me. I don't know any of his terminologies. He speaks some technical words which I do not know. He uses some gadgets. I don't know what. The only gadgets I know is computer. I know Deeparadhana and all that. I know those gadgets are all very comfortable with. I don't know what he is using. So he uses all that. He has some report and all. He says your heart has been torn open and stitched. Now what will you do? If you say that, no, I don't believe. Let me find out for myself. We will posthumously prove your point. This is what will happen. At best, what you will do? You will go to one more cardiologist. He will also, if it is so, he will also say the same thing. So this is equivalent of what is called aptavakya. There are two experts, you believe in them. You without belief, you can't go one step forward. What did you do? You finally believe in the doctor. The doctor said, you know, you some strength has to be put into the, better listen to him. Without faith, we cannot go one step forward in life. So to think that this faith are all is old-fashioned, rational people who have blind faith and all that, they have not understood life. Without faith, you cannot take one step forward. Leave that aside. If you really ask me, what is the greatest strength of a Nobel laureate? It's only faith, nothing else. It's not his chemistry knowledge and all that. Chemistry knowledge is not why he got, there are so many people who have chemistry knowledge. Good professors are there. The Nobel laureate's only raw material which led him to Nobel Prize is he had a faith, he had a Shraddha, something is there. He doesn't know what it is. He took 30 years to find what it is. 30 years he took, I mean, finally he'll give an interview. In the interview, he'll nicely say, nobody knows what is the hard work he put. 30 years of hard work for what? For nothing. One day some spurnam happened. So even in Vyavaharika world, without Shraddha, knowledge is not possible. Please understand. I am now talking only in the Vyavaharika world. Without Shraddha, gaining superior knowledge is impossible. My own understanding is greatest knowledge of a Nobel laureate is only because he has deep faith. Unshaken faith that I am going to find something interesting. He may not even know what is that interesting thing. The only faith is he is going to find something very interesting. This is the only thing day in and day out, 8 hours, 10 hours, whatever it is, 8 hours, 10 hours, he will get into the laboratory. Tirelessly he will work for 20 years. On what basis? Shraddha. This is as far as his Vyavaharika. Let's talk about Paramarthika. In the case, so far what you have said is for superior knowledge we need Shraddha. So this must be true. But then we have another important reason to understand. So in order to understand that, we will see Adi Shankara's definition of Shraddha, which is there in Viveka Chudami. It's a nice definition. So what is he saying? He's saying Shastrasya Guruvakyasya Satya Buddhya Avadharana Sa Shraddha Kathita Sadbihi Yaya Vastu Upalabhyate. So he is saying, he is defining Shraddha in a particular way. What is he saying? Shastrasya, whatever is being told by the Shastras, which means Shruti, Smriti, Puranas, all these, there is an order, there is a hierarchy. But this entire corpus of knowledge, Dharma Shastra, is a corpus of knowledge. Shastrasya, Guru Vakyasya, what the Guru said. Okay? Satya Buddhya, saying this is Satya, this alone is Satya. All the time, this is what it is. That, you know, Ekagrata, that this is the only thing. That attribute, that way of doing is called Shraddha. This is what he is defining. So we have to understand why is he saying it. This is very, very important to understand. See, there is a difference between Atma Vidya and this Apara Vidya. You know, science, chemistry, management, physics, whatever. Some technology of doing something. All these are in the world outside. These are all in the world outside. Our knowing process is initially, and to a large extent, it is in the world outside. Correct? Chemistry means you go to the laboratory, you read a book, you go to the laboratory, they actually show, pour the solution, then they say acid means blue and alkali means red, something. So we learn it slowly, slowly, slowly. We understand all that. This is as far as this kind of knowledge. What is Atma Vidya? Atma Vidya is Indriya Param. Atma Vidya is Ati Indriya. Atma Vidya does not come through the indriyas because it is happening inside, it is not happening outside. Anything happening outside, you can use indriyas. You can use your eye, you can use your ear, whatever, all that you can do. Atma Vidya is not in the world outside. Atma Vidya is in the world inside. This is the first thing. All other Vidya is outside world. Now why? So what? First of all, the first implication of that is your indriyas are of very limited use. The jnanam that he is talking about is Atma Vidya. So the indriyas are of very limited use. It doesn't help you in any ways. Now, if you look at Nyaya Shastra, then there is an elaborate discussion on pramana. What if, when you have to make a statement, our Indians have been very, 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 very thoughtful about how to make a statement. There is a Padavakya Pramana Shastra. There is a Pada Shastra, there is a Vakya Shastra, there is a Pramana Shastra. If only you know Mimamsa, you will get Vakya Shastra. If only you know Nyaya, you will know Pramana Shastra. If only you know Vyakarna, you know Pada Shastra. Otherwise, no. Without reading these three, we cannot make sense of Indian knowledge system actually. Pada, Vakya, Pramana Shastra is very important. In that, there is this Pramana Shastra. This is where we have to understand. Now, anything for outside, there are some normal Pramanas. Pratyaksha, Anumana, Upamana, Artha, Patti, all these are there. Question is, what is the Pramana for inside? Indriyas, all these are, you know, only with Indriya you can get Pratyaksha, Anumana, Upamana, all those are only with Indriyas. Some comparison, some connection, some whether this is like this. He is like steel. He is like a steel means we know what is steel. Then we know some properties of steel is what he is talking about. So it's all outside. Whereas Atma Vidya does not have any, Indriyas have very limited role to play. Finally, Jnana Sampadana happens without Indriyas only. Because as I told you, it is Anubhuti. If it is Anubhuti, if it has to happen inside, all these Pramanas are of no use. That is why for Atma Vidya, there is only one Pramana. That is Shruti. Shruti is the Shruti Vakya. Shruti Vakya is the Pramana. This is point number one we have to understand. That's why that is coming. Shastrasya is coming only because of that. Otherwise, that statement should not come. The only, because certain things cannot be resolved. Because it is beyond, Atma Jnana is Atindriya. Therefore, you cannot use your normal methods of evidence and comparison and get Atma Jnana. So you need, but evidence, you need some Pramana for being satisfied that what I am doing is right and what I am doing is the right way. That is where Shastra comes. The second most important thing is when you say Anubhuti, see, even if you take Vyavahara, things on experience, things we have to gain on experience, correct? It is very often we ask a very elderly person who has gone through the experience. That's a very efficient method. You can say, doctor does not know, I will start reading what is cardiology, you can do it. Best thing is to listen to him. He said that there is a problem with your heart, it requires this kind of intervention. To come and get admitted, we will fix everything for you in 2 hours. There is an expertise. He has that anubhuti of what it can happen, how it will, all that he has. So this is an efficient first step. It is not the final step, but it's a first step. It is an efficient first step. So in the same way, when you say Atma Vidya, Guru Vakyasya. Because we said Brahma Vid, the definitions of Guru, Shrotriyam, Brahmanishtam, right? That is the kind of definition, you know, Akahamatam, Avrujinam, you know, all those are there. Vrithananya Upanishad, you will see what is the lakshana of, you know, all the Upanishads you will find in the first paragraph. You will find what is the lakshana of, and yesterday we saw the lakshana of a Guru from, there are 8 shlokas in Viveka Chudami. We saw some of them. Ahetuka, Ahetuka Daya Sindhu. Right? Brahma Vitta. All those are there. So if somebody has so much of experience, and what we are trying to understand is in the domain of experience, don't you think it makes a lot of sense to also listen to what the Guru says? It's the most efficient way of going faster. That's why I said yesterday, Guru is like a catalyst in a chemical process. The Guru will not take part in the reaction, but he will speed it up. He will speed up the process. Reaction will happen. He will facilitate the conditions so that the. So that is why Shankaracharya gives these two important things. Shastrasya Guru Vakyasya Satya Buddhi Avadharana. This is Dharana. All the time, you should not even a split moment. You should have an iota of doubt that what, you know, there's a problem with a lot of people, a certain type of people. They go and approach a guru. The third class, they start finding out how much guru knows more than me or what are all the areas which, you know, you will go nowhere. That is not a lakshana of a shishya, the adhikaritva is not there. That's why satya buddhiya avadharana. That's what it is, satya buddhiya avadharana. Satya buddhiya, all the time, not even an iota of moment of a time, you should think that, you know, there is, you know, I know a little more than that, this is not what it is, then we will not go anywhere. It's very simple. We will not go anywhere. So that is the meaning of that shraddha. So Krishna wanted to emphasize this very clearly. So in the next shloka, he brought the negative of it. To make it absolutely sure that you don't miss this point, in this shloka he said, Shraddhavan labhate jnana. The next shloka he said, if you don't have shraddha, you will perish. So we will see that shloka. He wanted to be very clear.
Ajnascha shraddhadanascha samshayatma vinashyati nayam lokosti na paraha nasukam samshayatmanaha.
To the best of my knowledge, in Bhagavad Gita, this much of course I have not seen in any of the shlokas. Samshayatma vinashyati. It's a very powerful, strong statement. That kind of a statement you don't find in many of the shlokas. It's a very, very strong force here. Krishna is saying, samshayatma vinashyati. The doubting tamas will perish. Simply because he says, ajnascha, one who does not have jnana. Ajnascha, if you don't have jnana, at least you be a mumukshu. Jignasu, you develop a deep desire for jnana and show shraddha. You are not even that. Ajnascha, ashraddha danascha, you are not willing to put the shraddha which is very required. You are neither having knowledge nor having the frame of mind to show shraddha towards Shastra and Guru Vakya. You don't want to. You always think you know something more than that, or you start doubting the credentials of the Shastra and you know this is not right, I know what it is and all that. Moment you do that, he says, he becomes a samshayatma. Because slightest doubt, forget about even Vedanta, all these you can do even in your vyavahara. You are working with some person in the family. Why do you go up to some person? In the family, the day you got the slightest doubt on somebody in the family member, the day you got the slightest doubt on your boss or subordinate, that's the end of your journey. We all have our experience in that. You know, it creates so much of distress for us. It creates so much of, it unnerves us. And we start working differently and all that. That is what Krishna is saying here. He's saying, a samshayatma will perish. No, perish, what it means? What it means is, in the journey of jnana sampadana, he has lost out. He is an utter failure. That is the meaning. Vinashyati ityukte, what he is saying is, in the so-called journey of jnana sampadana, you have wasted your time and all of them have gone to vyartha. Sarvam nasham sarvam vyartham abhavat. That is the meaning. Samshayatma means, moment you come with a doubt and doubting the scriptures and the guru, and you start thinking that you know better and more and all this, Ankara has now popped up in a big way. Ankara, Ankara has opened. If that happens, this journey is an utter failure for you. The whole thing is a waste. So you get nothing now. Na ayam loko asti. What is there to achieve? Because our ultimate goal is for that realization. Satyam jnanam anantam brahma. That is all we want to know what it means. You want to have the experience of that, that goal will be lost. And for that goal, again and again and again, we come janma mrityu jara vyadi, janma mrityu jara vyadi, like that we keep on going. So that purpose will be lost. That's why he says, na ayam lokosti, na paraha. Because as I told you, this is the karma bhumi. In all other places, for your good punyas, you can go holiday timeshare and come back. Kshine punye mrtya lokam. 3 days, 4 days like that, that's my favorite example. Because everybody understands it. You have a Sterling holiday resort, 4 days in a year you are booked for it. Go for 4 days and come back. Life as usual after you come back. This is the karma bhumi. So if you have made this effort worthless, all your the other places, what to talk of? There's no point. That's why he says, na paraha, na sukam, samshayatma, because he becomes ayukta. ನಾಸ್ತಿ ಬುದ್ಧಿರ ಯುಕ್ತಸ್ಯ ನಚ ಯುಕ್ತಸ್ಯ ಭಾವನ ನಚಾ ಭಾವಯತ ಶಾಂತಿ ಅಶಾಂತಸ್ಯ ಕುತ ಸುಖಂ. ಮೊಮೆಂಟ್ ದ ಡೌಟ್ ಕಮ್ಸ್ ಯು ಬಿಕಮ್ ಅನ್ ಅಯುಕ್ತ. ಯು ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಯುಕ್ತ, ಯು ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಸಿಂಕೋರನೈಸ್, ಯು ಆರ್ ನಾಟ್ ಇನ್ ರಿದಿಮ್, ಯು ಆರ್ ಅ ಸ್ಪ್ಲಿಟ್ ಪರ್ಸನಾಲಿಟಿ ನೌ. ದಿಸ್ ಡೌಟ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ರಿಮೂವ್ಡ್ ದಟ್ ಸಿಂಕೋರನಸ್ ಫೀಲಿಂಗ್ ಇನ್ ಯು. ಸೊ ದಟ್ಸ್ ವೈ ಕೃಷ್ಣ ಸೆಡ್ ಇನ್ ಚಾಪ್ಟರ್ ಟೂ ಇನ್ 57th ಶ್ಲೋಕ, ನಾಸ್ತಿ ಬುದ್ಧಿ ಅಯುಕ್ತಸ್ಯ ನಚ ಅಯುಕ್ತಸ್ಯ ಭಾವನ ಅಭಾವಯತ ಕುತ ಶಾಂತಿ ಅಶಾಂತಸ್ಯ ಕುತ ಸುಖಂ ನ ಶಾಂತಿ ಅಶಾಂತಸ್ಯ ಕುತ ಸುಖಂ. That's why he says, na shukam samshayatmanah. You can connect it to that shloka. Na shukam samshayatmanah. So he says, so Shraddha, he wanted to emphasize so much. He brought the positive effect of it. And the next shloka, he brought the negative effect of it. Then the last two shlokas are concluding shlokas. All that has been discussed in this chapter is in a way concluded with these two shlokas. We look at those two shlokas. Yoga sanyasta karmanam jnana sanchinna samshayam atmavantam na karmani nivadnanti dananjaya. Yoga sanyasta karmanam, we saw those 12 principles. We said jnana agni dagdaha nitya triptaha nirashrayaha siddha siddhau samabhavaha, right? Aparigraha. By all that, what will happen? That is really the sannyasa means, he clarifies it in chapter 5, he clarifies it in chapter 18 also. Sannyasa means not giving up work. It is giving up the karma, our asanga with the karma pala. Karma pala asangasya tejanam eva sannyasa. And that who, the one who does it is truly a yogi. In chapter 5 and chapter 6, he clarifies it in the first 5-6 shlokas. This is what he first taught. Arya Ruksho, Munoro Yogam and all, Munoro Yogam, all that he says there. So it is giving up that karma, the icha, that deep desire that we have for karma phala. If you are able to do it, you become a yoga sanyastaha. Yoga sanyastaha cha. Yoga sanyastaha. That's how we should take. You really practice karma yoga. By that 12 principles, he said, karmani akarmaha yapashyet, akarmani cha karmaha sabudhiman manushyeshu. He saw that and saw all those shlokas. If you do all that, you become yoga sanyasta karma. You engage in this world of activities with the sense of karma yoga. That is the real lens of karma yoga. Karma pala tyaga. Karma pala tyaga is sannyasa. Krishna says that karma pala tyaga is sannyasa. So once you do it, you become yoga sanyasa karma. Jnana sanchinna samshayam. Just now he said, if you have jnana, all your samshaya will go. So chinna samshayam. All your samshayas are destroyed. Vidyate hridaya grandihi, chidyante asya karma. All those will go. Sarva sam, you know, all that yesterday in Madhubhavarita I was saying. How tasmin drishte paravare, when you, once you get that vision, the Chijjada granthi will loosen. Everything will go. All samshayas will go. So jnana samchinna samshayam. And he becomes an atmavantaha. Atmanyevaratihi, atmatruptihi, atmanyevatasadatasya, you know, ramanaha bhavati. He revels in him. That is what will happen to him. Because all these distractions are gone now. There are no more distractions that you have to worry about even when you are engaging in the world of action. So atmavantam na karmani nibadnanti, the work will not bind him. He will be liberated from the effects of work. Our problem is work is affecting us. Something happens, it affects us. Either the result affects us or somebody told something about it, I expected and it did not happen. 100 things happen to it. He said, you will be released from the bondage. That's why he said in chapter 3, again I was mentioning that. Yajnartham karma lokan andyatra karma bandhana. If you do the yajna bhava, that is fine. Loka, lokaha, loko andyatra karma bandhana. Tadartham karma kaunteya mukta sangha samachara. Develop that sense of mukta sangha. Karma pala asanga, just leave it. Remove that connection between the two. So if you do that, na nibadnanti dananjaya. He is only telling him, he is only summarizing all his discussions with this shloka. And one more shloka. tasmat ajnana sambhutam kristam jnanasinatmanah chitvainam samshayam yogam atishto tishta bharata. Tasmat, therefore, he says, I have said all these to you in this chapter. Therefore, he says, jnana asina, asi is this sword. Jnana asina, with the sword of knowledge, right? Jnana asina, right? Enam samshayam hristam samshayam, this doubt that is in you, in your heart, doubt is, you know, that I have not got the jnana. As I told you, until we get the jnana, we all the work that we do is because we don't know what is perfection. We are striving for perfection. And we have our own meaning of perfection. Somebody thinks making money is perfection. Somebody thinks getting power is perfection. We try everything possible. That those are all those doubts in us. These are all those, manaklesha, aspashtata. Spashtata, na, aspashtata. All those in our heart, they are all, where do they come from? Ajnana sambhutam. So, ajnana sambhutam, all these are adjective for samshayam. Ajnana sambhutam, kristam, enam, samshayam, jnana asina, chitva. Cut it. Use the sword of knowledge and then slice off all this. Right? And that is the state of yoga. Yogam atishta and uttishta. Get up. You are now, what is the problem with Arjuna? Arjuna got too much involved into some emotional things which are in front of him. He didn't have that spashta jnana. So there is this confusion which he has all gone through. So he says, once you get that sense of discrimination, that viveka, that samyak jnana, then yogam atishta, uttishta. Get up. Why are you, because he said in the first chapter, he said, Guru Nahatva Mahanubha, the second chapter he said, right? Pujaha Varisudana, how will I, do all that? He was in the lowest level of his, this thing, personal, mood and his, this thing. So he said, get up. Once you take the sword of knowledge and then cut all your doubts, you will get that Tesham Aditya Vajjnanam. That's what he says in 5th chapter. All these are, Mukhyanti Jantavaha Tesham Aditya Vajjnanam. That's what the next sloka he says. This jnana will be like sun which is coming out and then shining in our this thing. So you do that. By doing that, you will come out of everything. So these last two slokas are quick summaries. I will take just two slides to summarize the whole chapter. We have gone through all the chapter. Just take two or three slides to just summarize so that these important things must be in our mind when you say we have gone through chapter 4 of Bhagavad Gita. First of all, these entire shlokas have four themes. This whole chapter, you can mentally think like that. The first 12 shlokas are Avatara Purusha. Yada yada hi dharmasi, he brought him there. Katam yetat vijaniyam tomado proktavaniti. So when he replied all that, aparam bhavatah janya param jannam, all that he says, yada yada, he brought the avatara purusha mahima. Avatara mahima and jnana tapas, puta madbhavam agatara, bhagavah jnana tapas, all. First 12 shlokas are avatara mahima. Then, Shloka 13, Chaturvarnyammaya system Gunakarma Vibhagashaha Arabhya. What is karma? What is akarma? What is vikarma? What is karmani akarma? What is akarmani karma yata? And then those 12 ideas of how do you discover the joy of this is a very, very important idea we have to remember. Because karma chitta shuddhyarte na vastu upalabhyate. The first step for us to get chitta shuddhi. And chitta shuddhi will happen only through karma. Na karmanam anarambat naishkarmam prusho shudde. That's what Krishna said. Engage in work. Work will evolve you. Work will make you this pure gold. 99.99% gold. Then jnana sampadana. So for that, those shlokas are very important. Then he brought this bridge between karma and jnana. through this Arpana Buddhi, Jnana, through this Yajna. We saw those 12 different types of Yajna, so many, you know, Dravya Yajna, you know, Swadhyaya Yajna, Tapo Yajna, Jnana Yajna, all that. Prane, Apana, Apane, Prana, all that. Vaishwanara Yajna, I talked about. So many Yajnas. He says, once you are doing the work, you develop so much of dispassion. That's why in Yajna, I always say, Namama, Namama. We are all meant for it. Indra, Idan, Namama. That Namama is very, very important. That is why in every ritual that we do, in the Yajna, Dana, Tapak, Karma, Pavanani, Manishnam, these three are very important. So those ideas came. Then once he did all that, the Jnana Prashamsa, these five great principles of what exactly is Jnana, what will Jnana do to us. In order not to get confused with all these Apara Vidya and these chemistry, physics and all that, he wanted to very clearly say what this Jnana will do for us. That is how he ended the chapter. And therefore he motivated Arjuna that you must now take the sword of knowledge, cut your all samshayas and move forward. So there are these 12 which we saw. I want you to remember, this is very, very important. They are very practical guides. Don't take it lightly. Our journey in evolution critically depends on our ability to, you know, follow this. It may take several janmas. Let it take. Let us not worry. The path is very important for us, not the end. We should be in the right marga. You should not get into the wrong road. Get into the right road. Krishna beautifully gives 12 principles which we can, simple principles, difficult to implement, but if you are ready to do it, the Bhagavad Sankalpa will come, the grace will come. Kama Sankalpa Varjita Bhavaha, right? Jnanagni Dagdaha, he uses all those. Karma Pala Sangha Tyaktaha. Karma Pala Sangham Tyaktua. I have converted everything into a first person noun to just say, such a person should do that. Nitya Triptaha Nirashrayaha Nirashi Yata Chittatma Tyakta Sarva Parigraha Yadrichalaba. These are great ideas. If we can practice Yadrichalaba Sadhushtaha, half of our problems in life will go. Our quality with which you do karma will change. I am telling you. One idea out of this Yadricha Lava Santushtaha is enough. It will qualitatively change our approach to the world and what we do and so on. Dvandvadita Bhavaha, Vimatsara, all these are related to one another. In fact, that is the advantage. 2, 3, when you do 4, 5, also join with us. Slowly everything will come to us. That is the nicety of this. I think we must seriously take this. To me, this is very important because karma, with karma, if you don't get chitta shuddhi, jnana sampadana will never happen. That's why I again and again say, nobody can take sannyasa. Sannyasa must take you. You cannot take sannyasa. You will create mess in the ashrams and wherever you go. You have to do all this. You have to drop everything and it will, that agraha will happen from the other side. That's why these are very, very important principles. Finally, I just want to put these 5 principles also for us to remember that this power of knowledge should not be this. Paravidya is the ultimate for which we should strive for. We say, sarvam karma ikilam jnane parisamapyate jnana plavane eva plavane plavane eva vrijinam samdarishyati sarishyasi jnanagni sarva karmani basmasat kurute nahi jnane nasadrisham pavitram iha vidyate and shraddhavan labate jnanam tatparas samyate indriya. I think these are very, very important. We don't have to rattle our mind too much. This just last 2 slides is enough for us. If we can practice this, I think the grace of the Lord will be with us. It will be 100% with us. We have to only make a commitment now and here that in a small way, we will take a small baby step. It will be a giant leap into our journey, into our self-evolution. I think that is all Krishna, with infinite compassion, he is telling us. Out of infinite compassion, in Avatar Purusha Sakshat, Vishnu has come and said this to us. So I think we have to understand the power of this. We have to understand what it really conveys to us. So with this, let us say, Om Tatsat Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Su Upanishad Su
Brahma Vidyaya Yoga Shastre Shri Krishna Arjuna Sambhade Jnana Karma Sanyasa Yogo Nama Chaturthodhyayaha.
I am very thankful to all of you. It is the grace of the Lord that we are all here. As I have been saying, satsangas you cannot attend that easily because there are so many attractive thousand things outside for a variety of reasons. So I think the grace of the Lord is with us. That is why we have come. I am very grateful to every one of you because you gave me an opportunity to self-reflect. Every such talk is actually my offer of pranams to all of you, that it makes me self-reflect. You gave me that opportunity. So first of all, I offer my pranams for that. I also pray to, you know, Sarveshwara, I pray to Jagatguru, Gitacharya, Sri Krishna, that we all are endowed with complete paripurna shanti, tripti. All that we want to achieve in our life, let Lord Krishna be with us, guide us in the path that we have to go, and bless us with what he thinks we should be blessed with, and give us that grace of developing the prasada buddhi and the sharanagata bhava. With these few words, it is also my great opportunity to offer my pranams to my guru also, who has so kindly agreed to come, finally came today. I am blessed to have him here today. Om Tat Sat.